Welcome, and you have just joined the Father Show, and I'm your host, Mike Thompson. So I really appreciate you being here today. Thank you. And if you have a moment, tell somebody else. We have a great show lined up, so I don't want anybody else to miss it, but let them know. Call them up and tell them. We are right here on Christ the King Radio at ctkradio.org, and you can also find us on the Father Show YouTube page as well. So find us, check us out, watch the video, or listen to us on Christ the King Radio. So we are sponsored in part by Winston Hills Ribs and Stuff at 5090 East Arapahoe Road in Centennial, Colorado. When you get there, let Ron know that you heard about him right here on the Father Show. And we also sponsored in part by The Modern Gladiator, which is a men's online magazine, and women, you can also enjoy it as well. It's a great magazine. It has a lot of great articles. And matter of fact, one of the writers in that magazine is joining us today, so we're going to introduce him in a second. But check out The Modern Gladiator at www.themoderngladiator.com and check out that magazine and let them know you heard about it right here on the Father Show. Now, the Father Show Resource Program is a nonprofit organization, and we are having a couple of events that are coming up. One is our Choice Program is a program that we do in the schools where we teach kindergarten through 12th grade kids about making the right choices in life. Now, we are finishing up our year this year, and in May 31st, we are having a big banquet over at Axel Academy. And we'd love for you to come out and check us out and have some fun with the kids. It's a great time. So you can go on our website at The Father Show, R as in resources, P as in program, .org, and look on the calendar and you can get some more information. Stay tuned. I will let you know the address and all that. And we're also having a suit drive. And we are asking men to bring in suits that, you know, you're not wearing anymore, it's gotten old. Maybe if you're like me, your belly's gotten a little bigger and I can't even button them anymore. So we are asking men to bring out suits so that men that are in need and don't have a suit can get one. And we're inviting both parties to come out. We're going to have tailors, barbers, photographers, resume writers, and alike, and we're going to have a great time. So join us on Sunday, June 5th at the Cable Center right here in Colorado. And that Cable Center address is 2000 Bichard Boulevard in Denver, Colorado. And we'll be having that from 1 to 4 p.m. on Sunday, June 5th. Come out and join us. Have a great time. Bring a few suits, but if you need a suit, come on out there and get one so you can have one when you need to get an interview or just going to church or what have you. But we'd love to see you. So today, to get down to the nitty-gritty and to the fun part, I have a young man in here that I met last year, but we have had multiple conversations, and I love the conversations that we do have. And I think today is going to be one of those that you're going to enjoy just as well. So I have Mike Valentine, and he has a unique view on the world, and he's driven to help everyone discover their unique gift, their purpose, and their vision. Modern Gladiator, who has enlisted Mike's expertise as a life purpose guide, finds a powerful journey of awakening in relationships of their greater selves, allowing their lives to be moved to the next level at all aspects. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce Mike Valentine. How you doing, man?
Mike, thank you.
Oh, my pleasure. I'm glad to have you here. We've been talking about this for a little bit, and so finally get a chance to get you on the air.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
Welcome.
I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, I am happy to have you. Very happy. So I wanted to, why don't you tell the audience a little bit more about you?
Gosh, where to start, huh?
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what.
One of the common questions that people ask me is, how did you arrive at the idea of being a life purpose guide?
Mm-hmm.
When did you realize that's what you would do? How did you develop yourself and train yourself to do it? And the best answer I have is, it started when I was born.
Mm-hmm.
But at the age of 14, I took a turn for the worse. And I spent 14 years down some pretty dark roads. And then a baby girl was born on June 28, 1988.
And do it every time.
But yeah, it will. And at that point, I realized that I had been on a heavy and hard path of destruction. And I looked into her eyes and realized there's something worth living for.
Mm-hmm.
And that I had a responsibility that I didn't know how to meet, but I was committed to meeting it. And so that was a major turning point. But then about 19 years ago, I started to really get interested in the idea of what is the difference between people who realize their potential in life,
mm-hmm.
and those who struggle. And what I realized is, some people, by hook or crook, accident or coincidence or divine inspiration, discover what their life is for, their purpose for existence, and then they start to organize their life around it. So I trained myself. I spent 18,000 hours leading leadership development programs. Mm-hmm. I was fortunate enough to become acquainted with and have a lot of direct interaction as a friendship with a guy named Dan Millman, who wrote a book called Way of the Peaceful Warrior. The beginning of my awakening was recovery from alcoholism.
Mm-hmm.
And then at some point about 11 years ago, I knew there was something in me that I had to activate, that I had to bring to life. And that's where I discovered every man has a gift to give, a purpose to live, and a vision he built for a better self and world. And all of the things I had done prior to that wouldn't get me through to the day-to-day practical application of my potential.
Mm-hmm.
And so the way it started is, I went to meet a man who wanted to explore what I had learned about using the power of purpose to lose weight.
Hmm.
And I met him at Racine's Cafe.
Oh, okay.
And within about 10 minutes, he had said to me, I'm overweight. My dad was mean as hell. My wife can be pretty grumpy. My kids are bratty. The dog doesn't know where to use the restroom, and the bank account is low. And something came up in me, and I think this is the first time I said it out loud, but I said, Jimmy, it's a man's work to give his gift, live his purpose, and build his vision no matter what. Either you're going to do that, or you're not. If you are, I might be able to help you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not, I'd like to buy your coffee. And he began to weep. He said, I have no idea what my gift is and what my purpose is.
Yeah. And I know you direct people on finding their purpose. How do you help someone find their purpose?
It's quite an unorthodox process, Mike. The best way I know to describe it is, it lay between your darkest grief. It lay underneath the cloud of your darkest grief.
Mm-hmm.
Where your heart was broke is where you left your purpose for most people.
Mm.
And we go sailing. I call myself a guide for a reason. I had plenty of that to sail through, to find my way out of.
Yeah.
To unwind and unwrap. You know, you ever been fishing with an open reel? Fishing reel with yeah. open and yeah. you throw it out and it winds up.
Yeah.
That's what my life looked like. It was a wound up mess and I had to unwind all that.
A lot of knots.
And I realized that I could go through that with people.
Mm-hmm.
And because I had been through it for myself, that I could help unwind a lot of that along the way. But right there underneath their heartbreak and their heartache.
Mm. Wow.
The gift, the purpose, and vision lay like a shining treasure. I can yeah. see it there.
Yeah.
So it takes courage.
It does take courage. And we got to take a break. I didn't realize I talked that long that we already need a break. So, ladies and gentlemen, you are watching The Father Show. And if you are an organization that provides resources to help men, I would invite you to go to The Father Show resource program website at www.thefathershow.org and click on resources and click on providing another resource and just fill out the information, and it's free for you, and it's also free for the men to go out there and be able to find your information. So I would invite you to do that and make sure that men can get the resources and the help that they may need when they need it. So you're watching The Father Show right here on Christ the King Radio at ctkradio.org. And ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back. Welcome back, everybody. And you have just tuned back into The Father Show. And we are here today with a special guest, Mr. Mike Valentine, the on-purpose guy. And I wanted to bring him on because so many of us have not always, you know, we don't understand or know our purpose in life. Excuse me, some of us are out there searching, wondering what is it that I'm supposed to do? And we were all here to do something. And it's not a mistake. You are here. You were put here for a reason. So, Mike, I know we talked about how you help a person find their purpose. And how can you guide someone to find out their life purpose?
I think people exist in three classes relative to their purpose. There are a small group of people who are going to discover and live their life purpose no matter what. You couldn't stop them.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to do it. They don't need any help to do it. They're on that mission. For whatever reason, it's integrated and ingrained in their existence.
Mm-hmm.
They know that their purpose will lead them to it and present itself to them. That's also true for everyone. So, to start with, let me say it this way. If you want to live on purpose, the next question is obvious. What is it?
Yes.
And if you don't know the answer to question number two, and you said yes to question number one, there's nothing else to do but discover it.
Mm-hmm.
So, in the early days in my work with purpose, I would say, ask the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Ask his dad if he doesn't answer. Ask the Holy Spirit. Steal mine. Take Mike Thompson's. Make it up. But somehow get yourself a hold of something that inspires you to do with your life.
Mm-hmm.
I since discovered that purpose doesn't usually live in form. It lives in spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So the spirit of your purpose is what you're really looking for, the essence of what you're here to do. Not necessarily raise a good family, but your purpose might be to love the people near to you.
Yeah.
And as a result of that purpose, you might raise a beautiful family. So the first group's going to do it, no matter what. I work with those people because I can add speed, clarity, and power for them.
Mm-hmm.
The second group of people are people that I would say they would like to live on purpose. It's interesting to them to live on purpose, and if they had a little help discovering it,
yeah,
they would do it. And then the third group of people, which I think is actually the majority, unfortunately, you couldn't make them live on purpose no matter what you did.
Yeah, and now, do you think it's a fear that some people have, so they don't live their purpose life just strictly off of fear? You know, they don't know the unknown or having to step out of their comfort zone.
That's a great question. I think that ultimately, if we were to look at our whole society and say, what would be any reason why someone would not live on purpose, we'd have to blanket that answer with because they're afraid. But it's not that simple.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in my conversation, I work with a lot of top-level and highly accomplished people.
Mm-hmm.
And often when I say, you have a gift to give, a purpose to live, and a vision to build, people are speechless. What is this gift? They don't even think about
right.
it. They don't even think about what that is.
Yeah.
Much less that I could have it. So, you know, it's not as black and white as, are they not doing it because they're afraid? Ultimately, yes. But they're unconscious.
Yeah.
And it's buried, and they would say, you know, who am I?
And when you say it's buried, one thing that comes to mind is, you know, how parents will help bury your vision and your purpose, where you might say, I want to be, and they said, no, you're going to be over here. So is that some of the reason why some people cannot find their purpose?
I would say that the best resource for burying our purpose is our parents.
We don't
bring, and I'll talk about myself rather than generalize it, but I'm a father of three.
Mm-hmm.
I have and am interested in what is their gift, their purpose, and their vision. Two of them are girls, one is a boy. The boy's done the work with me.
Mm-hmm.
So he, together with me, we've come to that. But even in the field, spending my life on this idea to the best of my ability, I still am tagged with getting them through a school system, having them learn how to take care of their food, their shelter, their sleep, their exercise,
mm-hmm.
learning them how to appropriately get their needs for affection met and their needs for companionship. And, you know, I'm quick to tell them they should be another way other than the way they are. And they don't always see how their purpose will get them through those things. So we bury it. I mean, and in my own case, you know, my dad and my mom, they weren't focused on their purpose. So
mm-hmm.
how could they help me and steer me toward
mm-hmm.
mine?
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't, and they didn't.
Yeah.
And you know, they later are glad I found it, but.
Well, wouldn't it, I look at it as sometime if your kid, you know, we do the choice program, and you've actually came and spoke with the kids. And there are some kids there that want to be surgeons, basketball players, and so forth. If their parents were to say, no, you can't do that, or you're not good enough to do that, and because they didn't find their purpose, or the way they were brought up, everything was squashed for them.
Mm-hmm.
So I know what I'm trying to get is to mother parents to understand that let your kid be who they want to be, and you're here to guide them through this life. And like you said, learning to have you exercise and eat properly and make your food and things of that nature. And, you know, when they come to you about, hey, this is what I want to do, how should I go about doing it? You know, how can we get parents to do more of that?
That's a great question, Mike. First of all, I would say that when you think of purpose in its essence or spirit, it's not usually to be a surgeon, a basketball player, a pastor.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just take surgeon,
mm-hmm.
right? I imagine it like a spiral, and in the center is your purpose. So back out here is surgeon,
mm-hmm.
right, out towards the periphery. If you know your purpose and from the inside out want to be a surgeon, your purpose might be something like, you know, to deeply care for the health of others.
Mm-hmm.
And a surgeon would be a good way to do that.
Right.
Or a pastor could be a good way to
yeah.
do that. basketball player, they're kind of concerned about themselves. They're not all that concerned about others, it seems. And winning's important.
But, however, even some of the basketball players, if you make it to a certain level, you could give back.
Many, many great platforms established. Yeah.
So,
but your question about parents, right? How can a parent teach their kid, or how can they help them be their self? First of all, I think there's one irrefutable law of humanity, and that's a law of free will.
Mm-hmm.
When we violate, and I sit with my hand in front of you right now and say I do it way too often with my children.
Mm-hmm.
But when I violate the law of free will, the repercussions are instant with me. They have their own thoughts. They have their own emotions.
Mm-hmm.
They have their own aspirations, and they have their own purpose.
Right. Mm-hmm.
If I'm not someone who can help them pull out their own purpose, the best thing I can do is live mine with them,
mm-hmm.
is discover my own purpose. And I do ask, and I succeed sometimes, and I fail more often than I wish. But I ask every day, how am I going to fulfill my purpose with this 14-year-old boy?
But I know it's got to be hard to teach a young person to live their purpose life, because you were gifted and learned at an early age,
mm-hmm.
and there are few people that have that gift, that they're taught. They know their essence is, you know, this purpose. So how do you help a young person, you know, find that? Because I think they're going to focus on, like you said, they're going to focus on being a surgeon or being a basketball player. But we're going to have to, we'll come back to that question when we get, but we got to take another break.
All right, fair enough.
But when we get back, we'll talk about how a parent or how Mike can help a kid find that purpose in their life. But you are watching The Father Show, and if you are a man and you are in need of resources, and what I mean by that, if you're looking for an attorney or a mediator or a counselor or somebody like Mike, go to The Father Show Resource Program website at www.thefathershow.com/resources/P/program. Look under resources, click on your state, and find the resources that you need that's going to help you. Now, here's the key. The Father Show Resource Program website does not collect your data. So we don't even know you were there. Our main purpose is to make sure that you have access to the resources that you need when you need them. So go there, find what you need. If you don't find it, contact us, and we'll help you get that information as well. So you're watching The Father Show right here on Christ the King Radio at ctkradio.org, and you might be watching us on our YouTube channel, The Father Show. So stay with us. We'll be right back, and we're going to continue our conversation with Mike Valentine, the unpurposed guy. Thank you. Welcome back, and we are here at The Father Show, and I'm your host, Mike Thompson, and today our guest is Mike Valentine, the unpurposed guy. And we were talking about, before we took the last break, we were talking about kids learning, or how Mike can direct a kid into finding their purpose in life and accepting that, their purpose. So Mike, how can they?
Well, if we pick up the conversation before the break, Mike, you were saying that it's got to be hard with kids because they're focused on things like basketball,
mm-hmm.
being a surgeon and that sort of thing. My discovery is, and I work with, right now I'm working with 6 youth from 10 to 18.
Okay.
Not many.
Mm-hmm.
But the discovery of their purpose is easier. If you said you only get to work with 2 age groups,
mm-hmm.
and you can't work with, you get to pick out 2 age groups, I would work with 5th grade girls and 7th grade boys.
Okay, why's that?
The grief is not as thick yet.
Okay.
They've got, so as we go through socialization and domestication, we develop a defense system,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
I call it the ego thought system. It's a way to get at, you know, our limiting beliefs about ourselves, what we buried, our purpose underneath.
Yeah.
And it's fully developed by 5th grade. boys don't seem to be able to unwrap it yet. Girls can. I don't know why that is, but the discovery of it is easy in that age range. The other thing that I think is an advantage is that they don't yet have 40 years of that defense system getting more evidence for that's true, that I'm limited, that I don't have the power of love at my beck and call, that I'm not supported by the benevolence of the universe, that I can't really create my life or be of service. So they don't have all that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll share, so they're clean is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
They're cleaner than, they're younger is cleaner.
Yeah.
At the same time, without constant reinforcement, because the system is consistently telling them that they're limited.
Right.
You got to do this, you got to do that, if you don't do this, right? They're not, our system is not saying you should rely on your faith, or you should rely on your purpose.
Mm-hmm.
It's saying you should rely on us, the big people.
To tell you what to do.
To tell you what to do while you're little, right? So, the discovery of it's there, but then constant reinforcement. My at the time, youngest client was a 10-year-old girl, and she is 13 now, and it looks like it took magnificently with her.
Mm.
I spent 18 months working with her once a month, and she seems to have been able to let go of that critical side, mostly, and develop. She had not been, you know, worried about a boyfriend yet. She had not been socially rejected in a major way yet, and her parents are both people who are very purposeful, and they have both worked with me.
Okay, so I was going to ask you, how did she find you?
Yeah, her parents essentially demanded I work with her between fifth and sixth grade, and I said, no, my track record's good with you, and I have no idea what will happen with someone that tender, that innocent, and that young, and they said, well, why not do it where your track record's good, because you can always recover. I said, okay, and so I did, and I've since worked with probably a dozen more, mostly boys. But one of them, and this will epitomize what it's like to work with young people, one of them is 11, and he's gone through the deep cycle with me. We cut to the core of it. We showed him what was in the way, and he was able to get his hand on his purpose. And we were walking through where I do my work one evening talking, and he saw a TV show, and he said, do you watch that show? He saw it through a window. I said, I don't watch TV. He said, you don't watch TV? I said, it doesn't fulfill my purpose to watch TV, so I don't watch it.
Mm-hmm.
He said, well, I watch this and this and this. You don't watch TV? I said, I don't watch TV. I said, one day you might not either. He said, well, look, this purpose is not going to take over my whole life. I said, Sergio, it's worse. This purpose is going to become your life. And he took a deep breath and he said, that'd be pretty cool. So he gets it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he's in school and the teachers are telling him that he can't be creative, he can't color outside the line. So I said, what are your two favorite school teachers? He said, the music teacher and the theater teacher. Yeah. I said, the creative ones, right? I said, and he started talking about one of them. He said, I think my purpose and his purpose are similar. I said, why don't you go show him your purpose and see if you guys can get outside the box with the school? So he did.
Yeah, I really wish schools, parents, friends would all stop trying to put people in a box. I know we have laws and rules that we have to follow, but however, you don't need to be put into a box that everybody else is fitting into or stuffing into.
Right.
I don't like living in a box. I'm not living in a box. I don't let anybody tell me what I can and cannot do, you know, in that asset. I don't want you to say, well, Mike, you can't do that because, you know, you got to do this. Well, why I got to do that? As long as I'm not harming anybody,
right.
You know, who says?
Right.
So, but, you know, I want to go back to something you said earlier. You had talked about free will. Why did God give people free will?
I was working with a man who lives in St. Louis. His wife drank abusively.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he had been codependent. He had identified that codependency and, you know, went to his faith and his prayer to find his way through that. And he asked me that question.
Mm-hmm.
He said, why free will? And I had been mystified by it. And I said, I don't know, but let me, you know, give some thought to it and see if we can understand that. And Mike, I went into, you know, my prayer, and I journaled.
Mm-hmm.
And one morning I woke up with the thought that love couldn't be love if we had to believe in it. It wouldn't be love. So God being love will let us do what we will.
Mm-hmm.
He says, you want that, have that. He won't dictate that you come to him.
Mm-hmm.
And so love, we if we didn't have free will, love wouldn't be love. It would be dictation. And
that's true. I mean, you have a free will to believe in God or not believe in God. That's your free will.
You can choose fear or love.
Yeah, other than that, it would be dictation. You are going to believe, or I'm cutting off your head.
Yeah.
You know, something like that.
Right. But,
it is, and I think it's hard for people to understand that they do have free will. And even in their day-to-day lives and, you know, decisions that they make, the choices that they make,
mm-hmm.
you know, is you have a free will. And we all know there's some repercussions for everything that we do, and especially if you're doing something negative.
Well, and the quickest route, the free will is power.
Yeah.
I can choose fear over love.
Mm-hmm.
I can choose truth over illusion. I can choose unity over separation. That's the power. That's how much God believes in us.
So how can
we can make that choice?
Yeah. How can you help somebody get from fear to living their on purpose, you know, to their purpose life and get to that point?
Most of us believe, and our society teaches us that most of us have no reason to believe that the more you look at fear, the more you see what's on the other side of it.
Mm-hmm.
So to start with, you've got to admit it. Admit fear for what it is. Fear is fear. Don't deny it, don't project it, and don't be confused about it. So the first step is to admit. The only way out of fear from where most of us are is through fear.
Mm-hmm.
Right? We need something to guide us through there, and that's purpose. So a mind filled with fear, self-doubt, and insecurity is insane. We wouldn't argue about that, right? They're afraid, they're doubtful, and they're insecure.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's insanity, right? They got enough. The mind that will admit that is sane. So the minute you start to look at fear, you're not it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You're out. You step out of it to look at it. And now you're in free will, or you're in freedom, and you can choose a purpose from there. So the best way out of it is to admit it.
Address it.
And to look straight at it.
Yeah.
Fear wants to hide in the periphery, but if you can bring it into plain view, it's gone.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, the power of free will is, the quickest access to that power is to respect your freedom to choose, to honor your decisions, and to hold reverence for how you want to create your life.
Mm-hmm.
If I do that for you, I did that for me. And I honor yours and mine.
Mm-hmm.
And the more I do that, whether it's with young people or power, or, you know, grown, powerful, influential people, the more I do that, the more freedom I have. And the more power of my own decision, my own choices, I start to see why God would give me free will, because he trusted me with it.
Mm-hmm.
Sooner or later, I'll choose.
Sure.
Love over fear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, now, in the modern Gladiator magazine, you mentioned a program called Ego Last Stand. Oh, we got 1 minute. So, let's come back to that question.
Okay.
But we got to take a quick break. And when we get back, we'll get into that question.
Okay.
But you are watching The Father Show right here on Christ the King Radio at ctkradio.org. And you can also find us on The Father Show YouTube channel. So you get to watch the video that we're taping even right now. So stay with us. Let someone else know that The Father Show is here, and we got Mike Valentine here. So stay with us. We'll be right back. Well, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. You are just tuned back into The Father Show with our guest today, Mike Valentine. And I'm your host, Mike Thompson, and we're just discussing the on-purpose, living your life in purpose, whatever your purpose may be or while you're here. And you know,
before we took a break, we were going into a question of, in Modern Gladiator Magazine, they did an article about you, and you said something about, you talked about a program called Eagle Last Stand. What is that?
It's actually an article that lays out the 12 stages. I call it the 12 stages of Ego's Last Stand. It's it's a map I use. I'm going to say it's a map of the journey to your purpose and to the discovery of your creative self. I won't get it right, and you can see it at themoderngladiator.com.
Okay.
But so I won't be able to get all 12 stages probably in the exact right order at this point. But the first stage is the rat race. People spending time to make money so that they can buy time later to do what's important.
Yeah.
And time's a myth, money's a myth, and you don't get to buy time in this gig. You can't buy any more of it.
Nope.
So the futility of the rat race is obvious if you look at it wired up that way. The second thing, the second stage is we hear some call beckon us. I think most people hear a call of some sort. Could be there's more to life. Maybe there's a purpose. Mm-hmm. Maybe there's something that I could do that makes a difference.
Different callings will come in different forms. Am I correct?
I think completely, yeah. I mean, the first time I remember hearing it for myself was after some really bad things had happened. I was a 7-year-old boy, and I had developed stomach ulcers worrying about things, and they would double me over. And I fell in the grass, and then I rolled over in the hot Texas sun, and I could probably tell you the shape of the clouds. But the thought was, there's something else available here. This is not right. Now I can look back on that and say, I must have known that this is a world driven by fear, and it doesn't have to be. That's what it looked like looking back. But yeah, I think that it comes in different ways. You know, I would say that most people probably feel it as a sense of yearning and emptiness. Yeah. They're chasing something. It said in a simple way, they're going to the dairy farm to get eggs. They're chased. Cows don't lay eggs. Chickens do. They're out in the world looking for their purpose, and it works the other way around. You discover your purpose and then apply it in the world.
And why do you think that the world puts so much fear into people?
Let's define fear real quick, right? False events appearing real.
Right.
Illusion. The illusion that we're separate from what's essential. You could say that the purpose of the ego is to prove that fear is real. What is essential, we could say love, purpose, power, what is essential is not here.
So why are we having this conversation in the world? I mean, we look at what's going on in the media. We look at the election. We look at the police shootings and so forth. And we know it's all, the media, I mean, just building up fear. You know, they want you to fear what's going to happen tomorrow. They want you to fear the police, and the police wants to, you know, we want the police to fear us, in a sense. Why are we pushing so much fear? Why are we not having these conversations about love and learning to love one another? You know, I just don't get it.
Well, if you think about, if you squeeze an orange, you get orange juice. If you squeeze a lemon, you get lemon juice. And out of a grapefruit, you'll get grapefruit juice. The world is full of fear. So as it's squeezed, that's what comes out of people, right? They've been piped full of fear. What we were talking about earlier, right?
Yeah.
The parents put fear into their children, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so they're full of fear. That's all they got to come out. If I fear their fear, I just add to it. If I fuel it with my anger, I just add to it. But if I meet them in a space of love, it dissolves. Something happens in that interchange. That's different. So why are we doing it? Most people don't realize they are doing it. But we're filled with the belief that love is somewhere else. Now, watch this, Mike. Almost all of the self-development, professional development, self-help strategies, mm-hmm. especially in business, are about getting somewhere else. Mm-hmm. When I get this much money, when you get that diploma, when you finally have that relationship, if you get a six-pack on your stomach, if you get down to 100, when there's better than here, that's better than this, they have something I don't, I'm not good enough, I'm not wanted, I'm not lovable, I got to be better, mm-hmm. right? All of that is driving us somewhere else. But the wisdom of the ages says the power's now. So there's something wrong with the system.
Yeah.
If the power's now, where are you going?
Yeah.
What are you trying to get to? How are you going to find it somewhere else if it's here?
Mm-hmm.
So we leave the power where it is to chase it somewhere else. Of course we're scared. We just left it.
And I think, I remember you saying once before that we have everything we need inside of us.
Inside.
Already. We were born with it. So to get that purpose, to keep you in, I think in some aspect now, I think society tries to keep you in fear so they can keep in control of you.
Right.
Instead of you having control of your own life.
Right. No fear, you can't control that person. A person that doesn't have fear, you can't control them.
Yeah.
You couldn't control people like Gandhi. You couldn't control Christ. You couldn't control Martin Luther King.
Mm-hmm.
You couldn't control Nelson Mandela. Mm. They didn't have any fear.
Right.
They lived fearlessly, or could say they lived purposely, powerfully, lovingly, peacefully in most cases.
Yeah.
They were peaceful about their...
Right. About their coming and goings and
yeah.
their day-to-day lives.
Yeah.
They lived in peace and lived in love.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you couldn't control those people. So the system wants to keep us in it, keep us in control, keep us under the illusion that our power, our peace, our creativity is somewhere else. Our happiness is somewhere else. If that's true, we're all truly in trouble.
Mm.
And it couldn't be true. Yeah. And the wisdom of the ages says it's not.
Yeah.
Buddha and Christ and Krishna and Tao and Takashla and Ra, they all said the power's now, in one way or another.
Yeah. Yeah. That's fabulous. I mean, I watch people on a day-to-day, and I watch the news, and I'm like you, I watch TV. However, I will only watch certain things because it is really poisoning the mind. And I try to tell the kids in the church program that the same thing, that you have to be very careful what you let go into your ears and get into your head, because it will affect you, whether you think it is or not. It will affect you.
Right.
So how can people get a hold of you that want to find their purpose in life and are tired of doing the same old thing day to day and not being happy? How can they find you?
That's easy. What I do is not easy to describe, as you can tell. So I don't have a great place you can go find all the information you want to find about me and living on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
So the best thing to do is send an email to mike@onpurposenow.com.
Okay.
Say you saw me on the Father's Show, and we'll schedule 20 minutes to talk and get those questions answered directly. If you can't tell by my passion and enthusiasm, I like to talk about living on purpose.
Oh, I know you.
So
I know it.
So if someone wants to schedule 20 minutes to talk about living on purpose, I'm putting that in my calendar.
Yeah, I know we've had conversations. We've had some great conversations, some that even brought us to tears. Mm-hmm. And it's really, I've been blessed to get to know you.
Oh, thank you, Mike.
I'm learning more and more my purpose. Well, I know what it is. We discussed that on off camera. But it is a blessing to be able to find somebody like you mm-hmm. to direct them. So if you want to get a hold of Mike, just email him at mike@onpurposenow.com. And contact him and let him know if you're tired of living your life and not knowing what you should be doing, or you do know and you just don't know how to break free and step out of that fear, you need to call Mike and let him help you get to where you want to be so you can be happy. Because ultimately in life, we all want to be happy.
Yep.
And you can't be happy if you're holding on to generations and generations of anger and doubtfulness and fear and things that people have told you that you really are not. So you have the power right inside of you already. So let Mike help you get it out so you can be happy, be fearless, and live outside the box. Don't live in the box. Outside the box. Much fun. Trust me. Mike, thank you so much for being here.
You're welcome.
I really appreciate it. We got to come back again because I know we can talk about parenthood and, you know, and we both talked about our road through this thing called parenthood. Yeah. And we both had some challenges, and I'd love to be able to let the audience hear something. So thank you, audience, for joining us on The Father Show. I really appreciate it. We're right here on Christ the King Radio at ctkradio.org. And you can also watch the video at The Father Show YouTube channel. And this show will be up there pretty soon. And let someone else know. Subscribe while you're there so you never miss another show. Thank you for joining us this week. God bless you. Have a great week. Live your on-purpose life. Call Mike. All right. Thank you. We'll see you next week.
Yeah! 1, 2, 3, go!